Hi everybody, my name is Andrew Shikyar, Senior Director of Marketing here at FIDO Alliance. Thanks everybody for joining today. It's great to have so many of you on the line. And I think this enthusiasm and engagement reinforces what we've been seeing at events around the world, which is that there's a very tangible interest in learning how FIDO's approach to authentication can be applied to IoT. Before we get started, just a few housekeeping items. First of all, this webinar will be recorded and the slides and replay will be posted afterwards and will be sent to you in a follow-up email. Secondly, if you have questions, feel free to ask them via the GoToWebinar client. We'll do our best to answer them midstream if possible, and also we'll have a Q&A session at the end where we'll be going through the questions that were submitted, and then we'll pick from those to ask Rolf and our panelists to answer. There are a lot of people on this call, so we won't get to all the questions. We'll do our very best, and we'll likely stretch the webinar by around 15 minutes to accommodate this large audience. Third, there's a survey at the end of the webinar. Please fill this out, as your feedback is very important to us and really helps shape this webinar program on a moving forward basis. With that, let's get started. We have a lot of human and canine.
It makes sense to me.
So, as there are many of you who are new to FIDO, I thought it'd be good to give a quick introduction to FIDO Alliance, and we'll give a quick refresher here, Rolf. If you could advance the slide. Very good. So some facts on FIDO. FIDO is an alliance of over 250 organizations from around the world focused on a relatively narrow slice of the identity stack, which are authentication standards. In short, FIDO is leveraging public key cryptography to solve the password problem that's plaguing businesses and consumers around the world, as we'll touch on shortly. FIDO was formally launched just around 4 years ago, and since then we've become the largest standards body and ecosystem focused on authentication. Progress has been quite rapid, with over 300 FIDO certified solutions on market that are being leveraged to protect over 3 billion user accounts worldwide. Here you see our board of directors. This is a cross section of leaders in telecom, finance, hardware, and software. The rest of our membership also reflects this blend of service and technology providers. We also have several government members, including representatives from the US, UK, German, and Australian governments. So it's a very broad group of contributors to FIDO's standards. So why are all these companies working together in FIDO? Well, for starters, the world has a password problem, right? So if you look at this matrix of usability and security, and we start at usability, we all understand as users that passwords are clumsy, hard to remember, and need to be changed all the time. So there's a usability issue, which results in passwords such as password, or 123456, which then leads to weak security. You know, not surprisingly, the vast majority of data breaches have involved weak default or stolen passwords, and phishing attacks, which are very effective, acquire these passwords and are growing at an increasing rate as our data breaches. As you see in the bottom statistic, there are nearly 1,100 data breaches last year, which is an increase from 2015. So this problem is not going away, which is what FIDO and our members are very focused on solving. So what can we do other than passwords? OTPs, one-time passwords, are another approach. These are better, but also have usability problems. So if you think about the token necklace challenge, for example, that plagues network administrators, right? So there's usability challenges, and for less technical users, there's also user confusion. And there's SMS reliability issues if you're sending OTPs by SMS. And perhaps most important, OTPs are still phishable, which is why NIST recently deprecated SMS OTPs as a form of strong authentication. So what we really have is not just a password problem or OTP problem, but what we really have, the world has a shared secrets problem, whether that's a password or an OTP response. So what we need is a new model altogether. And this is why we've had hundreds of companies coming together to work on developing the FIDO standards and the FIDO ecosystem. So how are we going about creating this new model? First, we're creating open standards for strong authentication. To date, we've released specifications for both second factor and biometric authentication, and we have ongoing work with the FIDO2 project alongside W3C that includes added use cases and will make support for FIDO authentication even more pervasive in leading web browsers. We're also working on a variety of extensions to our core specifications to address emerging use cases, such as those that we'll explore today, as well as work with groups like EMVCO. We're also investing in ecosystem, primarily through our FIDO certified program that's resulted in the 300 plus FIDO certified products that I mentioned before. And this very competitive ecosystem is underpinning a variety of deployments that are providing a superior user experience and higher security on a global basis. So backing up a bit, let's look at, where things stood when FIDO got started. This is how old authentication works. It's basically a shared secret model where a user authenticates themselves by presenting a password in response to a static or machine-generated challenge. And this leads to the problems that we talked about before. By contrast, this is how FIDO authentication works, albeit at a very high level, and Rolf will go into this in more detail shortly. But core to this approach is a user authenticating locally to their device by establishing a private key, whether that's a second factor token or if you're using a biometric on mobile. The device then authenticates the user leveraging public key cryptography. So this protects user privacy while ensuring strong authentication. The net result is a simpler, low-friction authentication experience that's easy for users to understand, easy for users to leverage. That's also a much stronger authentication experience that brings added privacy benefits as detailed on this slide. So as you'll see here, FIDO really has delivered a new authentication paradigm, delivering simpler, stronger authentication, blending the best of usability and security into a single set of specifications that are being adopted worldwide. And the world indeed has taken notice, with leading service providers having now rolled out FIDO authentication to protect over 3 billion user accounts worldwide, including groups like Facebook, Google, NTT Docomo, eBay, PayPal, and many, many more. And we'll see this list of companies expand in the months to come in parallel with the work we're doing within FIDO to evolve the specifications along with very important policy and go-to-market activities that FIDO is driving. So mission accomplished, right? But actually not quite. There are a number of adjacent solution areas where FIDO specifications for simpler, stronger authentication can apply, and where there's also a very clear market imperative. And that leads us into today's conversation. IoT, of course, is one of these areas, one of these solution areas, one of these imperatives in the marketplace. And the world very much has an IoT security problem. We're also going to be touching on this in much greater detail shortly, but it's safe to say that the world has an IoT security problem. A baseline use case is securely authenticating users to a home automation workflow, and we've had members such as Infinia and Overture, CipherBridge, and many others all demonstrate FIDO solutions for this problem. Beyond that, there's potential for leveraging the FIDO specs for device-to-device authentication, which has been addressed by vendors such as Knock Knock Labs. And there's still other IoT use cases that FIDO members are getting their collective arms around as we assess the best ways for FIDO to address this industry imperative. At the end of the day, the industry needs a new authentication model for connected users and devices, and Rolf today will give you some initial thoughts on how FIDO standards can address this today and into the future. So thanks again for attending today. I hope the webinar gives you a better feel for FIDO's applicability to IoT. If you have any questions about FIDO itself, feel free to email me at the address on your screen here. And with that, I'm very pleased to turn things over to Rolf Lindemann of NotTalk Labs to talk about FIDO authentication and how to authenticate the Internet of Things. Rolf.
Thanks, Andrew. So hello and welcome to our webinar. So we heard that FIDO and what FIDO is and want now to see how we can leverage FIDO for the IoT space. And as you can see in this little nice cartoon, security is typically part of that equation. So we have to think how to make the IoT a bit more secure than we have the internet today. So you might remember last year's distributed denial of service attack. So there was an interesting attack last year, I think in October, where distributed denial of service attack was so powerful that a lot of websites essentially went down and couldn't work anymore. Now the question is, what does that have to do with IoT? Yeah, it was caused by IoT devices, which have somehow been hacked and hijacked to do things they should not do. So the cameras and DVRs are not the only vulnerable device type. There are a lot of other devices which are vulnerable, and this is, for example, shown by HP study, as you can hear see on the screen, that a lot of home security systems do not require strong passwords. Only a single of the tested systems supports two-factor authentication in general. And if you look at the OWASP Internet of Things top 10 vulnerabilities, you see that insufficient authentication and authorization is one of the most important root causes for hacked solutions for device takeover and so on. And now we have to see how we can fix that issue. And now to give you a little context on that, in order for secure IoT devices, you need different things, and authentication is only one part of the equation. You need a strong fundament. And for example, a CPU supporting concepts like ARM Trust Zone or Intel SGX concepts. And you also need strong walls and windows to protect that device against attacks. Essentially, have doors inside that building and strong windows in that building in this analogy, right? Meaning that the device firmware actually needs to leverage those CPU concepts for implementing resilience. For example, severing a network stack from the device, in the device firmware, from the firmware update verification engine to make it possible to even update malicious firmware after the network stack has been hacked. And certainly, you need to shut the front door. And this was, to come back to the first example of the distributed denial of service attack, one of the reasons why people could simply hijack those devices, because there was a default password or an empty password, so that attackers could simply take over those devices. So even if you have the windows and a strong fundament, you need to shut the front door. And this is where authentication fits in. So this is the focus of today's presentation, right? We don't want to look into the trust zones or the SGX concepts today, but the authentication, the front door analogy. Now, even authentication in IoT is a wide field, and let me explain the focus of this webinar in a more precise way. So we have, in IoT space, we have devices, we have users, and often cloud services, and they somehow talk to each other. So users need to authenticate to cloud services, and this is not really specific to IoT, they always have to do that, and we have existing standards of that. So this is the initial focus of the FIDO Alliance, addressed by the FIDO specifications, by W3C web authentication, and it's not the core focus of this talk, but we will see how it fits, how it relates to what we will do in IoT space. And the second thing is users use their primary interaction devices for authenticating to cloud services, as they cannot authenticate to them without a local helper device, right? So if a device doesn't have a user interface, you need some kind of machine, a local machine for the user to authenticate and to configure to maintain that device. So the purpose of this, for the purpose of this presentation, we will define two device classes. One is the primary interaction devices, and the second is the others, right? The other devices like the smart light bulbs, the Wi-Fi routers, the smart fridges, etc. We will depict the first class with the smartphone, the primary interaction devices, and the latter with either the smart light bulb or with the thermostat, even though it could represent a lot of different device types in the end. And one more word on the primary interaction devices. Those devices can and should actually implement a FIDO authenticator. We won't really focus on this too much today, but the FIDO, the smartphone is not necessarily the only device which can verify the user. More primary interaction devices are coming, and they all have some kind of direct user interface which and can verify a user. And most of them might be specialized on one single modality. For example, if you look at the Google Glass, it might just implement an iris recognition in the future, or the NIMI wristband. It might just implement the ECG recognition and a FIDO authenticator on top of that. Or the Dash from Bragi could just implement a speaker recognition or something which can verify a user by looking into ear characteristics. And why am I focusing on primary interaction devices? These devices are the ones which we have with us all time, and this makes up one important factor already. This is the what I have factor. So if we want to have a two-factor authentication, we typically want to combine it with something we have, which could be the primary interaction device, and the second thing which we are or we know is either some biometric we present to that device or a PIN we enter to that device without requiring the user to carry an additional token just for authentication. We can already achieve that with those primary interaction devices. And as a result, I don't have to expose my password or my biometric to an unknown device, which could put me at risk, right? And you might remember all these ATMs which have surveillance cameras, right, as an attack to just spy on the password you're entering. Those things typically don't happen with your primary interaction devices because you control it, you know, and you trust that device. But back to the other devices. There are standalone devices without any cloud dependency, and I use a smart light bulb as an example for that. Users want to authenticate to those devices, and that's one focus of this talk. Some devices might not need authentication. Physical proximity, existing pairing with some communication protocol could be sufficient, but other devices might need more protection, and we will go to that and the reasons why they might want that. For example, there are accessible from the outside a secure perimeter or because they perform security relevant functions and need to be protected against malicious software which might run on devices located in the secure perimeter. And then there are other devices which somehow depend on a cloud service, and I use a smart thermostat, right? There might be cloud service which the device trusts, and the cloud service might be used to reconfigure the device, to send commands to the device, and the cloud service might, let's say, add value to that device. But there's some kind of connection. It doesn't need a physical connection. It doesn't even need to be an online connection, but somehow of a, let's say, trust relationship between that cloud service and that device. And users need to authenticate it to the related cloud service, log into the traditional web web portal with existing web authentication. But users might also want and even have a need to directly authenticate to that device, even if no internet connectivity is available, either to the device or to the user's computer or both, or the cloud service might be unreachable due to a distributed denial of service attack, as we have seen last October. So there are good reasons why users might want to directly authenticate to a device. So this is the second focus of our talk. And finally, one device sometimes talks to another device. This requires some form of machine-to-machine authentication. And some devices are connected to the cloud and need to authenticate to the cloud, another form of machine-to-machine, right? A device to the cloud connection. And we will see how FIDO can be used here as well. Now, to give you some background why authentication is required and what the role is, we will have lots of connected devices in IoT, at home, in companies, in public spaces, etc. And even if some of those devices do not directly talk to the internet, they will be connected to another device in order to do so. And as we learned from the recent past, some of those devices might be vulnerable to attacks. And it's typically the cheapest ones. As a consequence, we have to expect some malicious devices inside a perimeter. So it's not a secure perimeter anymore. This infected device might then be misused to attack other devices within the perimeter. So such other devices need protection capabilities, even if they are considered to run in a secure perimeter. Resilience in the firmware to make sure that bugs do not lead to full device compromise is one thing, but strong authentication, remember the front door, that's the other thing, right? So devices have to distinguish legitimate users from malware or malicious devices which have been hijacked. And this observation is not exactly new. You might remember this is perimeter security dead, right? And this slide is from 2007. This is quite old, right? But we just have to understand that what was true for corporate environments now will be true and will be applicable to our home environments and other IoT environments in general in the near future. So this has an impact that we cannot trust a perimeter anymore, that devices have to come with their own protection capabilities, including authentication. And this is the focus of this talk. Let's start with user-to-device authentication. So in general, if a user wants to interact with a device not having a user interface, he needs some kind of helper device, the primary interaction device, for example, a smartphone. And from the perspective of the IoT device, it's not a user authenticating to the device, but just another device. So that's the only thing the IoT device sees, right? So the device at the right-hand side would have to support any modalities for the users, for example, like fingerprint and iris recognition. And for security reasons, we don't want the device to store any bearer tokens, so no passwords. So this pattern doesn't look entirely new. We might have seen that before. And in fact, when I prepared that slide deck and looked up existing slides, I found that, yes, there is the FIDO Alliance and how web authentication works. And there is a user, there's the authenticator, and then there on the right-hand side, there's a cloud service. So what's different in IoT? So instead of the big server and trained operators of that big server, we have a small constrained device being almost operated unattended. And instead of millions of users, and many of them even in parallel, we have maybe 5 to 10, and typically not more than one or two at the same time. The keys, or the FIDO credentials, are still tied to one app. We use private keys generated and maintained by the authenticator to sign server-generated challenges. The server uses public key from registered authenticator to verify the signature. And each private key is dedicated to a single relying party. So we only store public keys in the IoT device, no user secrets. So in case of a hacked IoT device, there's only public keys which are exposed. So hacking of the IoT device is less attractive to attackers. And the user verifies whether it's the right context and service. The authenticator verifies whether it's the right user, and the FIDO server in the end, sitting in the device, verifies whether it's the right device. So and the right context. So altogether, this is exactly what we want, right? We want the right context, right service, the right user, and the right device. And if we can provide that assertion to the device, right, we can do a lot of transactions, including financial transactions. So what we have to do here really is to shrink down the FIDO server and take away all the things which are only relevant to supporting millions of users and a lot of users in parallel, to have it really small and fit into a small device. And as you might know, FIDO requires the authenticator to be registered before you can use it. And with difference to most cloud scenarios, the identity of the user typically is not that relevant for the IoT device. So instead of really binding the identity, right, why should my device know my name, for example, all these identity attributes typically are not relevant if it's a smart light bulb, right? So instead of building the user binding, we can leverage existing methods to prove physical access to the device and the authenticator at the same time. Right? For example, if the device has never been used before, so it's brand new out of the factory, or it has been reset to factory defaults, then we can just push a pairing or register button on the device, which opens a time window for the authenticator registration. Then we register our first authenticator, and this somehow locks the device down. Right? After that, this authenticator represents the administrator, and then this administrator would have to, let's say, configure the device, introduce other users to that device, less in that sense other authenticators which can be registered to the same device. But this is just examples of how you can implement that. Important is that there's a slight difference between, let's say, the relevance of the user identity. So it's less relevant the identity attributes of that user. It's just more relevant that this is the first user to use it and physical proximity, for example, at the first time of use. Later on, that user would just authenticate to that device using the same FIDO principle as we have seen before. And some examples of those standalone devices which do not depend on any cloud service are the smart light bulbs, Wi-Fi routers, webcams, and so on. So where typically a direct user-to-device authentication using FIDO is an interesting situation. Wi-Fi routers is a very interesting example because typically they allow authentication from outside your home network, which people still consider a secure perimeter in some sense, outside your home network into your secure network at home to, let's say, reconfigure the devices at home, right? Maybe even look at the surveillance camera who's ringing at your door, for example. But these days, typically a username password authentication is the only thing those Wi-Fi routers support. But let's say, to be honest, in my home, I wouldn't consider this secure enough. But if the Wi-Fi router would support FIDO authenticators, right, FIDO authentication, I think it's much, much stronger. And we can see, and if you look at the FIDO material published on the FIDO Alliance website, you see why it's much stronger than username password. It's much more robust against brute force attacks and so on. And even if people could hijack and break into my Wi-Fi router, they will not be able to steal my password from that device, right? Because it's only public key stored on that device. So I think it even enables new business models because security is relevant for a lot of those scenarios in the IoT space. But even more devices might somehow depend on a cloud service. For example, the Nest thermostats, rental cars, door locks in hotels, for example, the parcel lockers, and all those things. So as one example, we want a rental car company to grant access to a car to a specific user. Or we want a hotel chain to grant access to a hotel room door to a specific guest. We want UPS, DHL, and all these other parcel services to grant access to a parcel locker to a specific user. So after having the account to the Hilton.com website or DHL.com website to a web portal to maintain all my my account settings, I then want to go to a specific device and log in to that device. So in that sense, we have a cloud service and a device which knows the cloud service's trust anchor, right? It's think of the parcel locker, right? The parcel locker is somehow tied to DHL as the door lock of a Hilton hotel, for example, would be. So it can digitally verify the signed data from a cloud service. And to do FIDO here, right, you have this trust anchor injection into the device at the first step. And the second one-time step would be the traditional FIDO registration to the online cloud service. And sometime later, the user might just want to authenticate to that cloud service, for example, book a hotel room, And as part of the response you get back from the cloud service, the user might receive a data structure digitally signed by the cloud service. And this data structure, in this situation, and this is our proposal here, is the so-called proof of possession key. So it tells that the owner of that, the private key related to the FIDO public key included in the signed object, has the rights or the specific attributes as stated in that object. And let's look into that. Right. It's typically, and this is a bit technical, right? It's some kind of Base64 encoded object you get. It has three parts, the header, the payload, and the signature. And the contents in the clear is a bit easier to read. So let's look at, inside that thing. Right? There's a JOSI header with a key ID, an algorithm identifier, then there's a payload, including that public key, which is represented as X and Y. Right, it's an elliptic curve, a point on an elliptic curve in this case. And by verifying this proof of possession object, the device will get a reason whether to trust that FIDO authentication public key or not. And so what will happen in reality is that if you want to do FIDO authentication, you register your authenticator to the cloud service, and then the cloud service introduces that same FIDO public key to the device by the means of that proof of possession key. So the user's device will simply add this proof of possession token to the FIDO response once it runs the step four, the direct authentication from the user smartphone to that IoT device. And the advantage here is that the POP token alone is not sufficient for authentication, so it's not a bearer token, because you have to prove the possession of the related private key by running the FIDO protocol to that device. So essentially, that POP token replaces the FIDO registration operation to that device, so that each connected IoT device can reuse the cloud service's FIDO authentication key. It's convenient for the user because the user has only to register his device once. And then you just transfer this registration. It's an endorsement of that public key in the end to that device. The interesting observation here is when we use this approach, there's no need to change the FIDO stack on the user's device. So the FIDO client, ASM, and FIDO authenticator all remain unchanged as they are on the device already. And fortunately, there's a lot of devices supporting FIDO stacks already in the market. So the original FIDO authenticator can be used for this purpose. And the mobile app or the underlying SDK used by that app simply adds the POP token to the FIDO response before sending the response to the IoT device. And this is more than just a concept. So companies Gallagher and LockLock Labs have actually implemented this. And you can see this in the news. So that's it's publicly or has been publicly announced. And in this case, it's door access control. There's a door access controller which essentially runs the FIDO protocol between the user's smartphone via the door access terminal to the door access controller. And obviously, that's connected to some kind of cloud service, which contains all the permissions of the users to the different doors, to different buildings, and so on. So think of this as being the Hilton example, right? Even if it's not used at that company at this time. So this is how you could approach this FIDO authentication for hotel doors. And there's no reason why you couldn't do that. And in fact, you can do the same approach for cars as well, right? Think of the drive now experience, where there's just a car parking at the side of the street and you want to rent that car. So you open the app, you say, I want to rent it now. And then this your smartphone and the app might run a FIDO authentication protocol to the car itself, opening the car door, for example. And as a third example, you can do this the same with parcel lockers. And you might remember that some of the existing parcel lockers have security issues. So if you have followed this in the German news, there's a DHL, and they call it Packstation, and they had a security issue because they just used a one-time passcode, SMS OTP, for that purpose, so that people could misuse that parcel locker in the end. It's not that they would steal the parcels, it's just that they, in this concrete example, at this hack, they would just send drugs and other illegal goods to that parcel locker and someone else would take it from there. So it's just a distribution station. But more security for accessing that parcel locker would help to prevent this kind of misuse. Now, this was the first situation, the user-to-device authentication, even with the devices connected to the cloud or devices not depending on any cloud service. Now, the second use case was device-to-device or device-to-cloud authentication. And let's look into that. Let's ignore the potential cloud connection for a moment and focus on the something-to-device, right? Whether this is a smartphone with an authenticator in it or just a light bulb, that's details in this example. So from the IoT device perspective, the IoT device is running the FIDO authentication protocol. And how the authenticator verifies the user and even whether the authenticator verifies the user at all is an authenticator characteristic in the end, but it doesn't affect the protocol. So we could just think of this being there is some authenticator running an authentication protocol, the FIDO authentication protocol, to the IoT device. So the authenticator could be silent, meaning the authenticator will never ask the user for a user gesture, right? No need to present a fingerprint or involve the user by any means. And the authenticator, of course, can be embedded in a device like a smart fridge, for example. Now, the second scenario here was device-to-cloud authentication, right? Now, again, whether this authenticator runs the authentication protocol to another device or to the cloud service has no relevance to the authenticator. So this is, from a protocol's perspective, this is just bits and bytes sent over the wire. So there's no material difference to that. And, of course, whether the authenticator is embedded in a smart fridge or in a smart thermostat, that's also no real difference. So that would work as well. So you can use the device to cloud authentication with having a smart thermostat, having an authenticator embedded in that device and running that protocol to some cloud service or to another device and fulfilling the same characteristics, meaning proving that it's the right user in the right context with the right device, right, to the right service, and this all can be verified by the cloud service on the right-hand side. So conclusion here is that the authentication is the first experience of users with services and with the several device types. So we have to look into that, and there's a good need for users to support for devices to support different modalities to verify the user, more than just a username and password. And second, the authentication needs to be convenient for the user and strong enough for the purpose. And as we learned today, username password is not strong enough. And as we see with the empty and the default passwords, obviously it's not convenient. So we can do better than username and password and eventually even plus OTP. So in FIDO, and this was the good thing why we could apply that to IoT, we defined the concept of the silent authenticator. And these authenticators can be implemented in IoT devices. The FIDO authentication response can be verified on small devices, allowing the FIDO authentication to those IoT devices. And then if you combine FIDO authentication with the RFC 7800 POP keys, then we can even support authentication to cloud-connected devices or cloud-dependent devices. And some words on the authenticator, which might be implemented in a smart fridge or a thermostat. The concept of the authenticators in FIDO contains some core components like attestation keys and authentication keys and some optional components like the user verification or transaction confirmation. And in the case of silent authenticators, those optional components are just missing, right? This is visible to the FIDO server by the means of what we call metadata statements. So if you look into the FIDO specifications, you first see there is a definition of a silent authenticator. There's definition of a user verification method, which is essentially none, right? Which is the appropriate thing to use for silent authenticators. And if you look into the metadata statement specification, you see that the user verification details will include these user verification methods. So in case of the silent authenticator, it will just say, okay, it's a verify none. And then it's a decision of the cloud service or the device to either accept the authenticator for a specific purpose or not to accept that authenticator for that purpose. So I think that's the end of the core presentation at this time. Please let me know if you have any questions. I think we have enough time left to go through a lot of questions.
Yeah, absolutely. So thank you very much, Rolf. And thanks everyone for sending in some questions. We have several that have been submitted. I want to go through these. I think that the presentation should give you a good feel for the use cases that we're looking at and some of the technology actually at a pretty good deal of depth, the technical approaches that can be brought to bear against these use cases. So Rolf, let me throw some questions at you. First one, is a connected car not a primary interactive device? So another way of saying that is, can a connected car be a primary interactive device?
Yeah, a very good question. So for me, a primary interaction device is some device when this is when you see that, you would intuitively trust that device. And if you park a car, or especially a rental car, you see a rental car parking at some street, let's say at the first time of when you see that, you don't know whether this is a legitimate rental car or just some car. So let's assume that car would have a PIN pad where you would have to enter a secret PIN, right? If you see any car parking at the side of the street, you don't know whether you can trust the PIN pad on that car or a biometric sensor at that car or not. And so for me, just by looking into this characteristic, I would think that a car, in my opinion, at least a rental car, is clearly not a primary interaction device. If you look at the outer side of the car, right, it might be different if you look into the, let's say, the interior of that car, right? Once you have opened the door and now you have convinced yourself that this seems to be the car which matches the authentication credentials you have been given by the rental company, or if it's your personal car, sitting inside the car, it might be different, right? You might trust that internal system of that car, so you might want to transfer some credentials or register the authenticator or an authenticator, which might potentially be embedded in that entertainment system of a car with your existing, let's say, payment account. So the next time you just want to pay for gas, you might just push a button in the car and saying, yes, I want to pay. So let's say the rental car from the outside, I would say clearly not primary interaction device. If you have opened the car and the interior of a car, so the car entertainment system, if you will, that's another discussion, and that could be seen as a primary interaction device. But you're right, this is not a perfectly sharp definition. For me, it's just a class to understand that there is a broad distinction between different devices, which we typically have with us and trust because we have them with us and we know them very well. And they have user interfaces and other devices which either do not have user interfaces like smart light bulbs or which we do not trust because we don't know those devices, like, for example, ATM sitting at some kind of publicly accessible place at the street.
Okay. Thanks, Rolf. Here's another one. How can FIDO help with constrained devices?
Yeah, so another good question. This is a it's always a question, how big of a system do you need for verifying FIDO responses? And I would argue, and as this is what we learned from the experiment with or the pilot implementation with Gallagher, that you can really scale the FIDO server down to a thing which might not really look like a traditional server running in a big let's say, Tomcat web server environment, application server, but it's a more small thing, which is just some kind of SDK which you use inside the firmware of that device that verifies the FIDO assertions which are given to that thing. So yes, it really can scale down because FIDO uses very simple encoding mechanisms, either TLV or the JSON structures for that, which are simple, easy to pass in those systems. And they support elliptic curve cryptography, which can be supported and typically is supported by a lot of, let's say, constrained environments already. And if you combine those approaches with, let's say, the more advanced concepts like ARM Trust Zone or Intel SGX, as I've mentioned, this additionally adds a more security to that because it allows you to firewall very important parts of the firmware from other parts which are more exposed to the external side, for example, the network side.
Okay. Here's a good, as a reminder to everybody, I'm getting a couple questions on this. The deck will be emailed to attendees after the webinar, and the replay, the video replay, will also be posted on our website. Good question here. Are we dependent on IoT manufacturers to build in FIDO authenticators, or can they be added in after the fact?
Yeah, good question. I think the answer is it depends. Sorry for that, but this really depends on the structure of that IoT device. Most of the devices I've seen so far are pretty locked down, which means you cannot add in a FIDO authenticator or additional capabilities at all, right? If you, for example, buy a smart light bulb, that's typically not an open system. And whether the vendors move to open systems in the future, I think that that's another question, and this is an open question, in my opinion. So I think we primarily depend on the device vendors to implement a better authentication, for example, FIDO authentication, right away, straight in the factory as a replacement for the existing default passwords.
Okay. How can the user be assured that the device they're authenticating to is the one that the device claims to be?
Very good question as well. So the first thing from a security perspective, right, the user is never exposing secret information to that device. So even if that device would be or has been hacked before, right, there is no harm because there is no user secret which would be exposed to that device. So there is no password, essentially, no bearer token you share with that device. It's just a signature. Now the next thing is that typically before the app really talks to that device, it will require some proof of the device identity, and this could be leveraging, again, FIDO authentication in a device or relying on a TLS or DTLS authentication from that device to an outside service, or using any other protocol which provides some device identity back to that app, that the app really understands that this is the right device.
Okay, we had a couple of questions here on the topic of, you know, this presentation is obviously on how FIDO can address IoT. You know, how can this problem be solved if not FIDO? You know, what are some other alternatives that the industry is looking at right now, and what are the key problems, you know, in the marketplace? You know, we have fragmentation and things like that, but, you know, if not FIDO, then what is kind of the general question, Rolf?
I would look at the existing device landscape, and what we see today is that primarily you see username password schemes being used, and this was and still is a reason for a lot of the security attacks. So attacks on those devices. So that's not a good solution. We hear or have seen a lot of concepts where people try to use and actually use a PKI-based technology to authenticate one device to another device, or even try to authenticate users to devices. But this has a couple of issues. So for example, if you want to authenticate users to cloud services or devices, the PKI, the TLS client certificates have proven to be, let's say, not the right approach, very ineffective because of several reasons. One is a privacy issue that if you look at the TLS handshake, that the client certificate information is exposed in the unencrypted channel, it's transmitted in an unencrypted channel to the server, which is somehow bad because the device typically contains some identity information which you do not want to expose. sorry, give me a second. So the second is that you might want to use a PKI technology to authenticate one device to another device. So in that situation, you have basically two choices. You can either ask the vendor of that device to already embed a PKI certificate in that device, which would stay there essentially forever, and which is not good for two reasons. One is sometimes the trust of algorithms or the key itself might decrease over time. And second, there's the correlation handle issue. So if you want to sell that device to another person, right, on the second market essentially, right, you do not want to want the device to the old identity to that you essentially can track the device to different people, and that the device still inherits some history from previous use. And the second approach is that you do not want to have a central CA infrastructure, but you have expect a decentralized so CA infrastructure at the, let's say, the corporate environment or the home environment where you actually want to use that. And this comes with a lot of overhead because running a CA is by no means an easy task. And second, it comes with security issues as well, because you would have to protect the private key to the CA, but essentially that means a physical separation between the place where the CA runs and where the device is located. So the only way the CA sees the device is over the network. And with that, you are back to the question, how could the CA or the registration authority really know that this is a trusted device? So I think the FIDO response comes with much less overhead here. It's much easier to handle, and it allows a registration to different services, keeping or using different keys, so avoiding global correlation handles in the device. So it's much more privacy friendly in that sense. And the device history, if you do a device factory reset, is really completely gone, right? So it's really reset to factory defaults, and it's a new device. So if you sell that thing on the second market, there is no baggage which comes with that device. So I think to summarize that, using FIDO is much less overhead as PKI, and it's much easier because it has a clear separation between what we call authenticator attestation, so to know the model, and the authentication of a specific device, so the device identity in that sense. And this scales much, much better in reality.
Okay. Thanks, Rolf. Here's one statement earlier is that the IoT device did not need to store a private key, only public. How is the IoT device verified not to be compromised?
So first, if you want to authenticate to that IoT device, there is no need of the private key. It stores the user public keys in that way. There is no guarantee that this device is not compromised, right? By itself, you have to trust the firmware to do the proper device checks. And this relates to the prior statement in the beginning, where I gave some context, where you might want to leverage concepts like a trust zone or SGX for that device. So you rely on a strong fundament of the CPU to provide you a strong separation or protection mechanisms in the first place. And second, you rely on firmware really leveraging those concepts to implement more resilience. So the only information you can trust is essentially the firmware telling you that it's not compromised, which the firmware can do if it has the abilities to verify the firmware image against a reference value which is stored in a secure way, which essentially goes back to, yes, you need some kind of a strong CPU. The authentication is about locking the front door, right? So we need a strong fundament, and we need those, let's say, the windows to be closed and having doors inside the building, right? If you follow that analogy here. But then you have to shut the front door, and this is where authentication comes in. We really need all the three pieces.
Okay. Rolf, earlier on the presentation, you gave the example of the hotel door. In that example, how do you make sure the door can only be opened by the user for the days that they rented the room? So what mechanisms are there to prevent the user from coming back after they check out? Is that I guess the corollary question of that would be, is that in scope for FIDO, or is that another part of the identity stack?
So this is another part. It's not really part of FIDO. So if you look into the POP token, this is where you can encode the additional attributes and say, this is the EXP, right? This is the expiration time. So this is valid until, right, and this is second since let's say 1970. So this is valid until then, right? So this user can open the door of room 304, right, for this week and not beyond. This is attributes you have to encode, and this is not core FIDO's task. This is something you can use using the existing technology, in this case the RC7800 approach for that. So this is in another level of that identity stack, if you will. But to be able to run the authentication protocol between the user's authenticator, the smartphone, for example, and the door access controller, that's where FIDO comes in. So it's somehow you have to combine two different mechanisms and make sure that you really keep those different layers separate, because it makes the overall solution much more modular and easier to maintain.
Okay, great. Can you comment on kind of the size and speed of the FIDO authenticator on an IoT device? You know, what's the code size? How long does it take for an authenticator when provided with a valid response to validate the key? Just generally, what's the responsiveness of the FIDO authenticator on an IoT device?
So without giving concrete numbers, it's very good to look into existing smart card or the external tokens which are implementing FIDO authenticators these days, right? This is really very constrained environment, so you have to live with a couple of 10K, right? It might be in the 64K range or 32K range. So very small code in the end, running on relatively low CPUs. As you might know, the smart card CPUs, they do not run at 1 gigahertz. They run at a couple of megahertz. And then the response time is still below a second. So yes, you can scale it down. The most expensive operation inside you really have to run is the elliptic curve signature. And there typically are references for whatever platform you want to look at, how long an ECDSA signature takes. On the other hand, if you implement, let's say, the FIDO server part in a device, the most expensive operation is the verification of an ECDSA signature. And again, the code size is very similar. So even with a crypto stack, you can get below 100K in those situations. And this timing is the same, so it's below a second. So, and this for an authentication operation, it's typically in those environments you don't have massive user and authentication load on this thing. So if you can get that below a second, I think it can be used in reality.
Okay, we're at the top of the hour. Let's wrap on this final question here. What are the biggest challenges to deploying FIDO for IoT? What do you see as the biggest challenges, Rolf?
Good question. So at this time, this is really new. We have seen there are the first implementation we have seen. So in reality, the biggest challenge might be if you really are a relying party, you want to deploy the technology, you have to find a device vendor which is already prepared to implement this new kind of technology. So we know it works because we have done that, but this is not, let's say, not yet mainstream in the IoT devices. So this is what I see as the biggest challenge. The second thing is for me to come back to the strong fundament and the closed doors and strong windows. We need, let's say, a solid firmware for that. And a firmware bug is not a good thing. So this is all the typical thing, right? This is not really specific to FIDO. This is in general how do you get to a secure IoT solution? You need a good way, a strong firmware, and a good way to update that to avoid security bugs. And there are existing stacks you can already leverage. ARM embed is one example, but there are others as well. So it's an evolving ecosystem. We're at the early stage here, but I think it's the right time this year to start working on those, let's say, on the implementation with the vendors in the first place. And if, let's say, these deployments are big deployments and they have influence on the vendors delivering that or have a say in that or even participate in that implementation, that's the right time to do it this year.
Okay. Well, Rolf, thank you very much for your presentation, for answering all those questions. And thanks, everybody who attended today, for joining us and spending time to learn about FIDO's thoughts and approach to securing and providing authentication for the Internet of Things. Again, the slides will be sent out and a replay will be available. If there's any follow-up questions we did not answer, feel free to email myself or to info@FIDOalliance.org, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as we can. So this concludes today's seminar. Thank you again for joining.